In this video, we're going to learn to name and write the formulas for simple compounds. Ionic compounds, polyatomic ions in ionic compounds, and some simple molecular compounds. For ionic compounds, we can start with something relatively simple, NaCl. Na, as we know from the periodic table, is sodium. We'll capitalize that. And then Cl is chlorine. In this case, we know that it is chloride. So the way this works is the positive ion, and from the location of sodium in the periodic table, we know that it has a positive one charge because it's in the first column, group 1A. And chlorine likes to have a negative charge. We're going to change the suffix of chlorine to "-ide", to suggest that it's negative, or to indicate that it's negative. So sodium chloride. Another compound, Li2O, in this case, again, notice that we're putting the element that's going to be a cation first, and we know that lithium is group 1A again, so we're going to have a positive charge, and oxygen is in group 6A, so if we added two electrons, negative two, we would get to the noble gas configuration, so we're going to have a negative two charge on our oxygen. This is going to give us lithium oxide. And again, for the anion, we're going to change the suffix and put "-ide". Now notice that the name lithium oxide does not indicate the two lithiums in Li2O. But we know that we have to have two lithium atoms, or cations, to match the charge of the oxygen. So therefore, we do not need to indicate in ionic compounds how many elements are going together or ions are going together to make these compounds. These are relatively simple, and notice that I'm staying with main group. If we look at a transition metal, so FeF3, we know that this is iron, but iron is a transition metal, so we don't know what the charge is right off the bat. We know that fluoride is a negative one, and we know that in this molecule we have three of those. So our overall charge is going to be negative three. If we're going to balance our charge in this ionic compound, what is the charge that's necessary for our iron? Well, if we have three negative ones, that's negative three, we're going to need a plus three. So therefore, this is going to be Fe plus three with three fluoride ions. To indicate that in the name, we're going to put iron, parentheses, Roman numeral three, close parentheses, and then fluoride. So for our transition metals, and for those metals that do not have a definite charge as a cation, we're going to use the Roman numeral system behind. Let's try a couple where we go from the name to the formula. So magnesium oxide, we know that magnesium, Mg, is in the second column, or group 2A, so that's going to have a plus 2 charge. And oxygen, as we've already looked at, has a negative 2. So therefore, we balance that, plus 2, negative 2, that's 0. So we can just say MgO as the formula. Let's try another one, chromium 3 oxide. Here, we know that it's going to be Cr plus 3 and oxygen, negative 2. Now, we need to balance this, so the correct formula here, if we have plus 3 and negative 2, well, we're going to have two chromiums, which brings up the charge to plus six, and we'll need three oxygens. Three times negative two will give us negative six. So we balance our charge. So this would be the correct formula for chromium three oxide. These were some simple ionic compounds. We can make these slightly more complicated by starting to use polyatomic ions. In polyatomic ions, we need to learn the polyatomic ions. I'm going to list out a few here, but the list is a little longer than this depending on the text you're using. There's usually only one common cation. That's ammonium, NH4+. For the anions, there's a really long list. We have hydroxide, OH-, cyanide, CN-, nitrate, NO2-, nitrate, NO3-, Notice here that the ite had one less oxygen than the 8. This is a common system. Carbonate, CO3, negative 2. Bicarbonate, or often called hydrogen carbonate, HCO3-, sulfite, SO3-2, sulfate, SO4-2, phosphate, PO4-3, perchlorate, ClO4-, and acetate. This is a molecular polyatomic. Acetate is CH3CO2-. Now, when we get a simple compound with a polyatomic like KNO3, notice that the polyatomic is written together. We know that the potassium ion combines with the nitrate, and so we get potassium nitrate. Let's look at another example for polyatomics. Notice that we're still using the atomic nomenclature system. Here, let's take in parentheses NH4 to the second and then SO4. We know the NH4 is ammonium and the SO4-2 is sulfate. You can see here that we had to have two ammoniums for the one sulfate. But in the name, it's just ammonium sulfate. Since we know the charges of these two polyatomics, we should have been able to figure out the name. One more example, calcium going the other way, calcium carbonate. Again, calcium is group 2, so that's going to have a plus 2. And carbonate, we have to know what that polyatomic is. We know it's negative 2, so therefore our formula is just CaCO3. This is our simple ionic compounds. Those with just simple ions, cations and anions, and those with polyatomics. Now let's look at some molecular compounds. If we look at two, carbon with one oxygen and carbon with two oxygens, if we tried to use the ionic naming system, this would just be carbon oxide. But we can see here we have two different forms. That's because we're sharing electrons, not having a cation and an anion. So when we go to a molecular compound, ones with covalent bonds, we need a different name. What we'll use is for CO, that is a carbon with one oxygen. So we'll use the prefixes for one, mono. We delete one oxygen from mono to get the oxide. So monoxide, carbon monoxide. With the CO2, we have carbon again to start, but now we have two oxygens. So we're going to use dioxide to indicate two. This is the way that we can indicate the right number. Notice here that we cannot rely on the cation or the anion to figure out how many of the two elements put together. So we have to be explicit about that, and we use the prefixes to get us the right number. Let's try N2O5. With N2O5, we have two nitrogens, so it's going to be dinitrogen. The oxygen, now we have pentoxide. So dinitrogen pentoxide. So we have two nitrogens and five oxygens. Now there are some caveats to this. One of them is those that contain hydrogen. Another is those that have specific common names. And then we'll also look quickly at organic compounds. So if we look at hydrogens, they often use non-systematic names. So if we look at HCl, we're going to call that hydrogen chloride. It looks like it follows the ionic or simple name. We just leave out the mono. But if we go to something like H2S, this also does not have an indication that we have two hydrogens. So here we have hydrogen sulfide. So you see, when hydrogen, we leave out the prefixes. So it's a non-systematic naming system. And this is very common for anything that contains hydrogen. But we also have some compounds like NH3 that uses a common name. Nothing that's really related to any of the elements in there. For these, there's a set of common names we're going to need to know. This one you'll see quite often. This is ammonia, and you may be familiar with that. And another one where we do not use its non-systematic or systematic name, dihydrogen oxide or hydrogen oxide, but its common name, water. The other one we need to watch for are organic compounds, specifically hydrocarbons. For the hydrocarbons, we're going to learn a list of names, or IUPAC names. This is a group of names that have been decided on and are the official chemical names for these compounds. For this video, I'm just going to start with a few. One carbon, two carbons, and an organic hydrocarbon with three carbons. For the first one, the IUPAC approved name is methane. For two carbons, ethane. For three carbons, propane. It's usually best to know all of the IUPAC names for hydrocarbons all the way up to 10 carbons. But for this video, we just wanted to get you started. Now you should be able to name simple ionic compounds that contain polyatomics, and some simple molecular compounds.